Queen was very much a band on the rise at that point. Is this just
fantasy? And somebody did cut it down. I think John actually did an edit. Caught in a
landslide. It was either going to be massive or it was going to be nothing. No escape from
reality. There was never a discussion about, you know, who got killed and why was it all thrown away. Open your eyes, look up to the skies and
see. I'm just a poor boy, I need no sympathy. Because I'm easy come, easy go,
little high, little low. We'd had a big hit in many countries with Killer Queen, and the Sheer Heart Attack album had been a big hit as well. And before that, we'd had a smaller hit with Seven Seas of Rye, which is our first UK hit. And it was, so we'd had two or three sort of hit singles by then, and so we were at a very good point in our career, very much on the rise and doing very well. There were three of us writing then, and I think John came in sort of later, but Freddie was probably the most prolific, and Brian was close behind, and then I'd usually write one or two, and that would be it.
What always happened when we went in to record an album was that we all brought in our ideas, and, as I say, kind of plonked them on the table.
And the others would go, don't like it, whatever, you know, let's work on it. And just like that, really.
And from that, some would get thrown out, some would get developed, new ones would come in. And gradually there was a feeling of what kind of atmosphere on the album we were aiming for. Mama just killed a man, put a gun against his
head, pulled my trigger, now he's dead. Yeah, I just, but Freddie said, I've got this thing, and I immediately thought the melody was beautiful, the verse. Mama just killed a man. It's a very beautiful melody. And so that in itself was enough to sell it to me.
And I remember I was beavering away on Prophet Song and the things that I was trying to write. And Freddie was beavering away working out his piano parts and everything. And I remember hearing Bohemian Rhapsody at that time, thinking, bloody hell, that's pretty unusual.
All the elements were in Freddie's mind. He literally had them all lined up like soldiers in his mind. So, I mean, it really was all there. And all the harmonies, he wrote out in little blocks on the back of a telephone directory.
There were a lot of passages where something would happen and then there'd be silence and a count and then it would all start up again. You know, so there were long gaps in the recording. And we said, oh, what goes on there, Freddie? And he would say, oh, that's the operatic bit, you know, that's this bit. And
as we added the central sections, it became more and more outlandish and ridiculous. But I always liked the core of the song, and the core of the song is essentially the verses.
And I do remember a moment where Freddie came along and said, and I'm going to call it Bohemian Rhapsody. And you never knew quite whether Freddie was joking or what. You know, you never knew how serious it was, but it turned out to be serious. I mean, some of his ideas turned out to be not serious. but that one stuck. Too late, my time has come. What is Bohemian Rhapsody about? I don't think we will ever know. I mean, if I knew, I probably wouldn't want to tell you anyway, because I wouldn't tell you what my songs are about. I hate doing that. I think it sort of destroys them, really. Because the great thing about a great song is that you relate it to your own personal experience and you feel it in your own life. There would be many theories, I know, because Freddie was wrestling with a lot of things in his personal life, and he may have just chosen to put them into the song in that way. You know, he was certainly looking at rediscovering himself, and I think at that time it was probably too scary a thing for him to do. He actually did it later. I think it's nice to leave the question mark in the air. We had some discussion about what the solo would be like and whether there should be a solo. And Freddie was always very amenable to what I would like to do. So having got used to hearing them playing it for a while, I kind of knew in my head what I would like. So I asked for the chord sequence, which was the verse chord sequence. I see a little silhouette of a man. Scaramouche, Scaramouche, will you do the bandango? Thunderbolt and lightning, very, very frightening me.
Galileo, Galileo, Magnifico.
I would say all of Freddie's lyrical content is quite hard to figure. It has a sort of surface thing, and he always very cleverly denied that there was anything else going on except the surface. He always said, oh, my art's fish and chip paper, darling, it's gone tomorrow. But actually, I know that he did care a lot about his lyrics because he spent a lot of time doing them. But there was never a discussion about, you know, who got killed and why was it all thrown away. But he was actually pretty good on the guitar, and the heavy bit is actually all Freddie's idea. This is not my riff, this is Freddie's riff, the famous head-banging riff. Sure, there were a lot of times when we were thinking, well, you know, we're pushing this too far or whatever, because we were trying to push forward the boundaries. We were trying to do things which had not been done and people had said couldn't be done. When the album was nearly completed, we would ask everybody in our immediate surroundings what they thought was the single.
I mean, the record company, in their infinite ignorance, of course, immediately suggested that we cut it down, and so did our manager at the time.
And somebody did cut it down. I think John actually did an edit. So it goes from Mama Just Killed a Man, the ballad side, to the end. You know, the last bit of the ballad. You've got no operatic, you've got no heavy bit.
You have to take risks at certain points, and that was a point at which we decided to take a risk.
If we were going to go for it, you had to go for it. And we persuaded everybody else. Actually, probably Freddie persuaded everybody else, because you couldn't argue with Freddie once he got on a roll. But we just totally backed him up and said, look, this has to go out in its entirety.
Yeah, that's as it is, that's what it is. We think it's quite unique, and it was a sort of, it really was hit or miss. It was either going to be massive or it was going to be nothing, you know, ignored. The band was financially not well off at that point, having sold a lot of records. So we thought, hang on a minute, this is not right. We have to reorganise. And we actually started to actually reap some of the rewards then, you know. So it was a turning round point. I remember thinking, the band's got 1,500 quid in the bank or something at the time, and that's ridiculous. We're selling millions of records, you know.
What's the best Green song ever? I don't know, I think it depends from what point of view. I mean, Bohemian Rhapsody is certainly a damn good one.
It was a simple device to allow us to be touring and be on top of the pops at the same time. To the skies and sea. I'm just a poor boy. I need no sympathy. We were sort of recreating the cover of Queen 2, which is our second album. Believe it or not. The video was made as a promotional tool, and it was made using a video outside broadcast truck, which is normally used for sport at the time. It was like a freelance thing that happened to belong to our managers. Just begun, but now I've gone and thrown. The idea was to actually essentially shoot it as if it were live, and it was on our rehearsal stage in Elstree. And we wanted to had a little side stage, and we just lit it ourselves with overhead white light directly down. It's quite the opening shots of the harmonies, the a cappella stuff, was done on the side stage, and some of the tricky shots in the centre were done like that. But the core of the song was done on a live stage and with our stage lights. So I mean that was that to really sell the idea that Queen was in essence a live band, you know.
Will you do the bandango? Thunderbolts and lightning, very, very frightening me.
Galileo,
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 Figaro,
Magnifico.
I'm just a poor boy.
Yeah, it was all done on the spot, the special effects, and that the faces sort of zooming out. It's such a simple thing to do. You just turn the camera into the monitor. And it's like a visual feedback thing, and it's a very, very simple thing to do. The other effect was a prism lens on the a sort of multifaceted lens on the front of the camera. Very, very simple stuff, really, very basic.
Mamma mia, mamma mia,
mamma mia, let me go. Beelzebub has a devil put aside for me, for me, for me.
Videos then. I mean it was, you know, nobody did ever, you went to Top of the Pops, and then they might show it again, you know, if you were still there 2 weeks later, but no, nobody had videos, you know. And so that was what made it different. It was made expressly as a marketing tool, promotional tool for the single on video.
We thought we'd have a look at the old Bohemian Rhapsody multi-track. This is what multi-tracks used to look like. This is a 2-inch tape. In its original box, it says Bohemian Rhapsody Master. The other stuff's been taken off except for one song, which is Seaside Rendezvous. And that's what it looks like. This is Bohemian Rhapsody here. So that's what we're going to have a listen to. We've actually transferred it onto to a hard disk because we don't want to play this too many times now because kind of an antique, and it has to be baked. You see, it says baked at Harrison's because otherwise it falls to pieces when you play it. So these things are very delicate. They're sort of museum pieces now, but luckily we've rescued the information. And this is the track sheet, which I find rather amusing, because if you're wondering what Freddie Mercury's mind is like, this is his doodles. He was in the habit of, he was a compulsive doodler, really. And his doodles are normally like this, not at all like his illustrations. They're kind of strangely chaotic and unattractive. But this is the man who wrote Bohemian Rhapsody. So I don't think there's much chance of finding out what Bohemian Rhapsody means. That's the original one, which must be worth a fortune by now, I should think. You put it in a plastic sleeve. I think the most interesting thing to start off with is just the backing track, which is the way I first heard it. Piano, bass and drums. We'd normally do things anything up to about a dozen times before they would be ready, and there wouldn't be any repairing. Nowadays you could get into the hard disk and start repairing things, but in these days the take was the take, and you know, apart from very few little things, nothing could be done to it. So you use the take. You might hear the odd little glitch on the piano or whatever, but it would stay that way, and that's the human way it was. So this is the raw take without anything else on it, without any overdubs. No guitar, because I'm in the control room while they're doing it. Big moment. It's the moment. In the very beginning of that, you can just hear Freddie singing the guide vocal, which is keeping everybody in time, because it's leaked onto the piano mics. But normally he would have had a talkback mic as well. We've now listened to a lot of these in retrospect, and the quality of the backing tracks that Freddie and Roger and John would put down is just stunning. The precision and the feel, the energy, they were all great. You know, they're great musicians, and it was a great combination. For the heavy songs, it would be a different kind of backing track. It would be guitar, bass and drums, normally, occasionally with a bit of piano. But for these kind of Freddie songs, it would always be the piano, bass and drums. Bed, everything else would be overdubbed. I think Freddie was an exceptional pianist. He didn't actually rate himself very much, but he had such a unique style that no one else could quite do it. He didn't have the huge chops of a concert pianist, but he would learn things in his own way and play them immaculately with incredible attack and precision. It's almost like he had a metronome inside him. There's very few piano players that I've met have that ability to do that. A lot of them are very technically great, can do wonderful things, but they haven't got that wonderful sense of drama and the precision. I mean, it has to be said, he's like almost like a drummer playing a piano. He'll hammer it. And he didn't play like this. You've probably seen, he played like this. Like his own style, but there was a lot of force there, you know. It's totally like a metronome, you know. He's not playing to a click or anything, that's just the way he plays. There's a little glitch there, but who cares, you know. It's live. So when you hear that, it's kind of hard to hear the whole operatic thing in your head, but it's all in Freddie's head at this time. Devil put aside for me, etc. This bit is designed to have the heavy guitar on it, which we'd already discussed. Three very annoyingly difficult guitar runs there, which I always kind of fought with on stage. Again, Fred knew what he wanted there. Interesting to hear the real chords. Of course, the sort of orchestrating with guitars was something that I did as an adornment, but totally with Freddie's approval and cooperation. I remember wondering how far I could go in terms of sort of orchestrating it, and also how far I could go towards the end of the song, because it's very big in the middle, this song, and it goes down very tiny here. I remember thinking maybe that should be just piano, maybe I shouldn't be doing guitar on it, but Freddie liked just coming down to the little solo guitar. The harmonies at the beginning of this song are not all of us, they're just Freddie multitracking himself, so it'd be worth going back and listening to those. It starts off with Freddie's live count.
1, 2, 3, 4. Is this the real life? Is this just fantasy? Caught in a landslide, no escape from reality. Open your eyes, look up to the skies and see. Ooh, poor boy, because I'm easy come, easy go, little high, little law. Ooh, the wind blows, doesn't really matter to me.
Sounds kind of different without the lead vocal in there, isn't it? And of course he's singing to his guide piano, but the guide piano is taken out in the end because all you want is that a cappella piece on its own. So it's quite beautiful, I think. We have three different bass tracks, just to be different. They're all the same part, but it's recorded three different ways. One is direct from the guitar, the DI. One is direct from the amp, I think. And one is out of the speaker into the room, so you get a little bit of ambience on the bass if you want. So the bass sound is a mixture of all three. That was a favourite technique of Roy's, who wanted to get the most out of the bass. And Roy will always, when we were redoing this, I was reminded of Roy's technique. He would also play around with the phase switches to try and get the most out of the three different signals for the bass, which makes a huge difference. Again, for different colours, different songs, you want to have different effects. You can hear how locked in they are. I mean, Johnny's completely locked into Freddie's left hand, which is doing more or less the same thing. If done the backing track now, so now we're into overdubs. And I think, you know, the first thing that we overdubbed was normally the guitar. And there would be a lot of different guitars with different sounds on this. There's a lot of colours. Quite deliberately, I used all different pickup settings and different amps even to get different sounds, almost like you were building up orchestral sounds using different instruments. But the first thing is the guitar joins in on verse two, which is like this, and it starts off with little harmonics and it goes shivers up my spine. And we were very into doing, sort of deliberately doing little colours. So it goes shivers up my spine and there's a little bring, which I managed to make by scratching the strings behind the bridge. So you'll hear that. It's a little kind of shiver up the spine thing. So this is the harmonics here, and this is the shiver, I think. This is the harmonic. There's a little echo on that in the mix to make it sort of ethereal. It's the little shiver thing. And then at the end of this is where the song starts to grow and face the truth is where the guitars come in. It's growing in dramatic intensity. I don't want to die. Sometimes wish I'd never been born at all. And he goes off somewhere and in comes the guitar solo. Keen that the guitar solo should not be just like playing the tune again, because it's kind of lame, it's kind of weak. So this guitar solo, like a lot of them, should we stop for a second? This guitar solo is a kind of a separate tune. It's a little counter statement, and this do 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 is a, I don't know where it came from, but I could hear it in my head from the moments when they were practicing it. I thought that would be a nice little counterpoint to what's going on. So it's a verse structure, but the tune is completely different. See what's on here. Now there you have the three of us pretending to be girls, really. The female part of the choir. Do you want to hear it again? Go on. And lightning. So that's the top line. It sounds pretty weird on its own, but of course it all makes sense in the structure of the harmony. Let's try the next track.
Scaramouche, Scaramouche, will you do the fandango? Lightning, very, very frightening me.
It's another part. It's the same as this part, isn't it? And again. Any more here?
I think so.
Another one of those. So we would probably have done that three times. This one too, to see what's on here. This would be another part.
Thunderbolt and lightning, very, very frightening me.
So there we are, sounding like boys. So we did sometimes, and that's a lower line. Some of these lines are kind of strange tunes, and that's what happens when you're doing complicated harmonies. That's not an easy line to sing. These days we've been asking the cast of our musical to sing the lines live every night on stage. And these things are quite tricky, because that's not a kind of tune that you would normally sing. You know, tunes go up and down. This goes da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. It's very moving around little semitones at a time. Very tricky. I'm going to play that once more time.
Thunderbolt and lightning, very, very frightening me.
Yeah, it's a very, very odd line, that. Do we have any more?
Are there some up here? Did you do those already?
Don't think so. Let's try this. So those two tracks are two versions of the same line, and that's normally what we do. We would sing, three of us would sing the line once, double it, in other words, do the same thing again, and then probably triple it. So you have three tracks of us all singing the same line, and only then do you move on to the next part. So all these would have been here, although some of them have disappeared because other things got written over them. but they've all been bounced, and the bounce is over there. Thunderbolt and Lightning, Very, Very Frightening Me, all bounced together sounds like this.
Scaramouche, Scaramouche, will you do the fandango?
Thunderbolt and Lightning, Very, Very Frightening Me.
So it sounds like a lot of people singing, really, and part of that's good construction, and part of it's luck, because our voices blended very well. As soon as there was three of us singing, it sounded like quite a lot of people, really. It's because, you know, we were lucky in that we had different kinds of voices, the three of us. John opted out. John was not a singer. He took care of the low end. OK, the next section is quite interesting because it's Magnifico, and this is one of our favourite tricks, and we did it with vocals and we also did it with guitars. It's kind of lifted off Mantovani, really, or in the 30s it used to be called the Bells effect, I think. And what it is somebody starts off and holds the note, and while they're still holding it, somebody else comes in singing a different note, and then a third, and then a fourth. So you get this kind of cascade of harmonies building up. Starts off with one part, and by the time you get to the bottom of the cascade, it's a whole chord. So that's what we're doing here. Now, some of them are still here and some of them are not. And when we were trying to remix this for surround, I wanted it to go, oh. But it was quite tricky because we have the bounce, but we only have some of the separate parts. We solved it. We managed to get it to more or less do that, but it was by a little bit of trickery. So see if we can find these parts. This is Magnifico, right?
Galileo, Galileo Figaro.
Magnifico. So that's number two. And then if we put in number two and three, it should be like this. Magnifico. So it's all pretty simple. Great. And here we have four. Let's just build in stages then. Okay, four would be this. It's quite sweet, isn't it? And then five. Okay, we're only missing the Magnifico, but here it is. Magnifico. So they're all there. It's a nice little trick, and it does work very well. They have to be exactly in time, of course, and they have to be in tune. In this section, we have like choirs answering choirs, because we have one lot of choir going Bismillah, and another part answering them. So it gets more complicated here. You have a multi-part choir over here, and you have another kind of multi-part choir over here, and they're fighting each other. There's a lot of overdubs here. I don't know where the Bismillah ends up.
I think it's here.
Yeah? So the Let Him Go is another section of choir, and Roger is on the top. And there was a particular effect. I don't know if it happened by accident or not, but Roger was sort of carrying on longer, and we thought that sounded nice. So the choir sings Let Him Go, but the top line, which is just Roger, because he's got the highest voice, he's the one who can make those top notes really cut. He sings longer than anybody else. I don't know if we can hear the Let Him Go. Should we shove him up?
Let you go.
So there's another one of those cascades there, Let Me Go, which is constructed in the same way. And we're using the ranges of our voices because generally Freddie and I can sing quite low and Roger could sing very high. We can all kind of stay in there up to a point, but there's a certain point where Roger could just make those top notes count. So we're using all the range that we've got. And towards the end of the operatic bit, you've got the band coming in. It's almost like the band come back on stage. The guitars come in first, and then there's a different guitar comes in with a different sound, more harsh. And then when Freddie comes in, he's very harsh. He's really at the top of his range, and he's double tracked, and it's a magnificent sound, I think. The only person who came close to achieving it was Axel when he did the tribute. But Freddie had this amazing razor sharp top into his vocals, real crystal sound. It's double tracked here. And in the beginning, I remember it was going to go, so you think you can love me, leave me to die. But he changed it towards the end. It went, die, which is a lovely little touch. Just takes it way up there and really sends a shiver up your spine, I think. So you can hear it, it's not perfectly double tracked. Freddie could have done that if he'd wanted to. It's just slightly out. There's a bit of different expression from track to track, very much like John Lennon used to do with the Beatles. I mean, the Beatles were our Bible, has to be said, in a lot of ways. Although we were able to take some things further than the Beatles because we had better technology and we had the benefit of their experience. But the Beatles just did so many things right. And John Lennon double-tracking stuff would normally make it just a little bit different so you could feel the humanity of the two voices. It wasn't just like an automatic double-track. It was something special, and Freddie's done that there. So it sounds huge. Freddie was able to double-track himself so precisely that it would actually phase. There's another track on this same album, Love of My Life, where he's singing some parts and they're ooh, ooh. He's sung it three or four times and they are so close, it sounds like one voice but just has extra breath. In this case, it's not. It's like it's a rock and roll thing and just very, very powerful. Okay, there's a nice little piece of guitar multiplexing here. There's three little runs. I don't know if we can find them, can we? There's three different runs and they all have completely different sounds. So you get these different colours, different textures coming in the whole time. And there's a big chord over there someplace. The last run is double tracked in octaves to get again a different sound. And it's followed by the sort of big triumphant piano run up. So over there you have what is kind of, in my mind, my fevered brow, a kind of a trumpet section, you know, bah, 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 bah. And for that, I have a special little amp, which John Deacon made. It's a little Deakey amp, as we call it. And it's just very good at being overblown and making those kind of trumpet noises. So it's like a kind of very much a fanfare kind of thing. And again, it's a bell effect because they overlap each other, and the notes are held so that they add up. And it's a very different sound from the rest of the guitars on the track. It's much more like, it almost sounds like a trumpet when you first hear it, I think. So part of building up the whole orchestra sound in the middle was the percussion, obviously. So Roger's played a whole kit for the backing track, but he's now going to overdub other stuff. So there's an extra snare and there's some timps here we can hear here. See what he's overdubbed. Nicely tuned. And Roger actually did go on to play timps quite a lot. We had timps with us on tour and he used to do a whole timp solo at one time when we were at our most self-indulgent. I can talk because I used to do about a 15-minute guitar solo. Yes, also the sound of the drums changes in the heavy bit. It starts off quite a tight sound for the verses, but when it gets big and becomes live, the drum sound changes to a live drum sound. So that and the addition of the extra instruments really makes it a huge colour change, and that's partly why the song goes through all these different moods. Partly it's the way the music's arranged, but partly it's the sounds as well. So some overdubs you can hear. Big fill. Up there for emphasis, and there's a big riff on top of that, of course, guitar riff. This is the ambience. Ambience, of course, is the room sound, and if you don't have the room sound in there, everything sounds very small. If you put in lots of room, everything sounds very big, and if you're lucky, it doesn't sound echoey. It shouldn't sound echoey, it should just sound big and like you're in the room with it. We had a big thing about ambience, it has to be said, because we were signed to Trident Studios for our first record, and the Trident Studios drum sound was something legendary, and it was very tight. You could hear it on Carly Simon records, and the bass drum went and the snare went, you know, and everything was so tight and small, very clear for a certain kind of recording, but it was the absolute antithesis of what we wanted. And we had this big argument with Roy. I remember on one of the first days we were in there and we said, no, we don't want this kind of drum sound. We want the big, roomy drum sound. But we didn't really know how to achieve it. We were just boys, you know, and we pretty soon learned. But I remember Roy saying, oh, it's all right, we can do it with echo later on. Well, folks, you can't. It has to sound right on the night or else it's never going to sound right. So we very quickly, precocious boys that we were, forced everybody into recording the drums the way we wanted, which was in the middle of a big studio with mics everywhere and not too many mics close to the kit. So mostly when you hear Roger's kit, it's not like a mic on this, a mic on that, a mic on that, the way it's very often done even these days. It was really down to a few mics strategically placed at certain distances to get the bigness of the kit. There would be mics on the snare, probably, so you can add the close stuff in, but mainly it's an ambient drum sound. That's why it sounds so big. It just needed mixing, and there it was.
The editor of the Guinness World Records British Hit Singles book, Mr. David Roberts.
We're here to honour a very special band, but most important of all, a very special single. And the top 10, if I just take you through that top 10 first, looks very much like this. We have at number 10, Let It Be by the Beatles. 9 is Yesterday by the Beatles. 8, Wannabe by the Spice Girls. Number 7, Penny Lane, Strawberry Fields, double A-side by the Beatles. Number 6 is Angels by Robbie Williams. Number 5, Like a Prayer by Madonna. Number 4, Dancing Queen by ABBA. 3 is Hey Jude by the Beatles. Number 2, Imagine by John Lennon. And at number 1, Bohemian Rhapsody by Queen. James?
It's great to get an award like this. It's a great honour. We feel lucky.
You beat the Beatles, you beat Imagine. Pretty good going.
I don't think we really beat the Beatles. I don't think anyone beats the Beatles, to be honest. I mean, we're total realists, you know, and we love them more than anyone. But it's wonderful to be up there amongst such fabulous stuff. And it's great, as Roger said, to be thought of as so current in a way. Strange enough, it wasn't perhaps as much of a jump as people might think, because if you listen to some of the previous stuff, like Freddie had a song called My Fairy King very early on. Is it the second album we're talking about? First album, actually. You know, where he was beginning to do things that were very structured and very, not exactly operatic, but much more sort of classical influence to them. And so we weren't as shocked as you might think when he came in with the Bohemian Rhapsody thing. We just thought, great, you know, go for this.
What was your reaction about the record-buying public's reaction? Because it was at number one for 9 weeks.
Incredible. We're still getting over it, aren't we?
Yeah, fantastic. Ka-ching. Yeah. No, we're very pleased.
What do you think Freddie would have made of the fact that he'd written such a classic and 27 years down the line we're still talking about it?
He'd shrug it off, I think, and say, well, thank you very much, you know, and then he'd sod off for a good lunch.
Yeah. He'd say, oh, it's nothing, darling, you know, got plenty more of those in the pot.